Praise the Lord. Good morning, everyone. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers, uncles, brothers, grandfathers, all the men of God who are examples to the ones all around them. Thank you for your godly example. Thank you for your faithfulness. And good morning. God is good. God is good. So Roberto has been kind of an inspiration. You know, I tend to have some broad shoulders and don't feel the need to burden everybody with all my troubles and woes. But then I thought, well, is that pride? Or is that just me feeling like, you know, sometimes I think, well, I prayed, God's got it under control. And then I thought of the scripture where the disciples came to Jesus and they're like, well, there's this one spirit, right, that just, we can't do anything about it. And then so there's just some times where we need to ask for help. And it's been a couple weeks for me. it's been a couple weeks. My Uncle John was diagnosed with terminal cancer, and we were told it's just weeks. My dad was supposed to have hip surgery, full hip replacement on Wednesday. They called and canceled that after our fifth appointment had just been taken care of the seven we had to do this whole circuit, all this craziness. Vacation was arranged, work arrangements, care arrangements. They postponed it for 2 months. And then while I'm in the cardiologist's office with my dad, waiting for an echocardiogram, which was our, I think, fifth appointment of the however many we had to do, my aunt calls saying she had just taken my uncle to the emergency room. And he hadn't eaten or drank in 3 days, and she thought he had pneumonia. He was coughing a lot, and they did an x-ray that turned into a chest scan that turned into a PET scan that gave a terminal diagnosis. And he went home and very quickly went back into hospice care. You know, I've prayed a lot about it, and I don't know if this makes any sense, but there are times when there's just peace, and he's ready. And I don't feel the unction. Now, I don't know if that's me being selfish or not wanting him to suffer and not believing and having faith, but he's ready. And so my prayer is not for his healing, but that it's peace and that there's no pain in that transition. And I think it's days now. And it's, you know, it's hard to sit in the room and watch the ones we love slip away, but he laughs and he's joyful and there's peace. And he tells us that he's going. He's okay with it, and that makes me okay with it. And I had a conversation with my dad about this because my dad, who's contemplating major surgery, who has major health issues, my uncle's younger than my dad, and that's hard, you know, when you're losing people younger than you when you get into your advanced years. And I said, Dad, you don't have to worry. Do you think it's your time? No. Are you ready? No. I said, then you don't have to go. You don't have to worry. There's no worry. God gives us the fight we need when it's not our time. I think that we have the peace to let go when it's time to let go. There is a time and a season for everything. The Bible tells us that. And we may not like it. You know, we may not. But it is. And God gives us that peace. And so, on top of all that, there's the regular demands of life, right? I still have to get all my client work done. I still got all these sales done. I still got to do all these meetings. I still got to get in the car at 7 a.m. and be in a meeting by 10 and try and schedule another meeting on the way since I'm driving clear across Iowa and I have all these demands. And so this morning I was praying, i.e. complaining, i.e. laying my burdens down, right? And I was just struck. He says, I am El Shaddai. I am the God of more than enough. I am the Almighty God, all-powerful God, who is the source of provision and abundance. So whatever it is you need, if it's peace, if it's strength, our God is more than enough. And it's in the hard places where he just proves it over and over. And I'm overwhelmed with his grace and his love and his support. God touches me more than the tribulations and the suffering around me because he is so faithful. He didn't tell me to hush. He didn't tell me to stop whining. He wants me to open and share. And he wants all of us to know that it is never The struggle, the circumstance, the obstacle, it is never more than he is. And whenever we just stop, and whenever I can stop being stubborn and try to handle it myself, I've prayed so I think I've handled it, and I just keep pushing. I'm the ox, right? I just keep pushing and going. And sometimes it's hard to just stop and let him minister to me. That's so hard sometimes because I think of all the things that need to be done. I think of all the places I need to be. Got to make sure my uncle eats. I got to make sure he drinks enough. I got to, you know, be with my dad. It's Father's Day. How am I going to get back to be with him and be at the hospital? I can't be at two places at one time. I haven't mastered that yet. But God says, just stop. Just stop and be in my presence. And he reminded me in John 15:16, he said, you have not chosen me. I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. We were chosen, we were hand-selected by God for this time and this age to be the rock, to be the light, to be the salt, to be the peace for everyone around us. Every person that crosses our path is predetermined by God. And it is a chance for us to minister and to share this wonderful good news. And in Psalm 33:27, God says, I delight in your well-being. If my being is not well, then maybe I need to delight in his presence so he can delight in my well-being. In 2 Corinthians 9:8. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. The Lord said there's a difference between labor and work. If you're laboring, that's not of God. You're sweating, you're pulling, you're struggling, you're bearing a burden you were never meant to carry. But if you're working, there's ease, there's progress, there's peace in the job well done. And we are to have the wisdom to know the difference. He doesn't labor us, but he gives us things to do. He gives us work to do, but work is good. Labor is what sucks our strength. And lastly, one of my very, very favorite verses that I cling to over and over and over and over. Ephesians 3:19-21. And to know the love of Christ, which passeth past understanding, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh within us, unto him be the glory in the church by Jesus Christ throughout all the ages, world without end. Amen. Amen. He has it under control. I don't like to ever think I'm the only one that's got some work to do, but I'm laying down those heavy burdens, and I'm refusing to labor, but to just trust that the path laid before me, it'll all work out as he intended to in Jesus' name. Amen. So, anyone else have any prayer or praises? Yes. Roberta.
Excuse me. I was talking to a friend last night, and we were talking about my grandfather. He passed away, it's going to be 2 years, July 1st. And I was thinking about that, and I remember when my grandmother died, in 1989, it was a different experience because at that time,
James, did you have a prayer request?
Thank you guys enough for encouragement and wisdom. I didn't share this with you. It's not really surprising. It is to me. As you know, I've been in high B 13 years. I'm going to be the first to say that God showed favor at my store meeting. Tim was preaching and said, James, you know, that was the word God's going to show up.
Right.
Well, the lights, this bitterness now has changed me. I don't have the problems and the worry for what's going on. He showed favor.
Yes.
I've come in there and they're doing a store meeting. We're doing it, how productive people are, and what we need to work on. Next thing he goes in there, this guy's been here. Anybody know James? And they said, he's been here a long time. And they said, well, he rides his bike to work, he's accountable.
Mm-hmm.
I thought, what? And I didn't say anything, I was just speechless. But see, folks, if you listen to God and try to not take out the negative stuff, like you try to tell people, thank you, Tim, for showing me some different input, brother. Because God did show favor.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm feeling a little more freedom at work, so I don't have to worry about who's doing what. It is his favor. That wasn't planned that way.
Mm-hmm.
And
it was an answer to prayer.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Anyone else have a prayer request? Or Sheila?
To come home. So she's got to do 3 home passes and then she'll be able to come home for good. And
praise
we're looking
Lord.
For August, but that's just an answer to prayer.
Yes.
God moved in that situation. And the 24th this month, we're going to have a team meeting, meet with everybody and see how things are going. So appreciate that. And also, I asked you a prayer for Leah. She got sick last night and her diabetes went up quite a bit. She was really sick and she was feeling good this morning. So I asked prayer for her. She's my right arm. She's the other half of me. And, you know, she's gone. I always miss something because, you know, she is such a blessing. I mean, I just thank God for her. Because one thing I was always amazed when we first started dating is that she just believed God. I mean, that's what it just believed. If God says this, tell me to do it, I'm going to do it, Tam. I'm just going to do it.
Amen.
You know, and I learned so much from that, you know.
Praise
it's
Lord.
Not a matter if it makes sense to us. That's not even an issue. Okay? But it's being obedient to what God is. Because he said obedience is greater than sacrifice, you know. You know, and a lot of times, well, I'll do this, God, do this. As long as it makes peace with my mind, then God says, all I ask you to do is trust me.
Mm-hmm.
I understand what you're going through. Just trust me. That's all I ask.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it was amazing. When God was talking about a different time, when he talked about his son on earth, and you hear his voice coming. You know what it says, my beloved son? Hear him. Hear him. Hear him.
Amen.
Just listen to what he's saying.
Amen.
You know, because Jesus is speaking for God.
Yes.
The Father, what he's going to say. If you want to know what God the Father looks like,
look
right
at Jesus.
Here,
yeah.
It's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So I'm just asking you to continue your prayer for that situation.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. And I can't help but think, Tim, that situation is just an example of God says it's not good enough just to have home passes. I'm bringing her home.
Amen.
More than we can ask, more than we can imagine. And there was a time when bringing her home for a visit wasn't possible. And he said, now I'm bringing her home to stay. So that is a testimony of his goodness, and that we don't stop until we get the answer that we know in our hearts God wants to give us.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah, Myron. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Praise the Lord. Anyone else? All right. Well, let's stand this morning. Let's go before our Father. Heavenly Father, we just come before you this morning in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
We come before
Hallelujah.
You to call upon your name.
Jesus.
That you are the God of more than enough, Lord. That you are the God of provision and abundance, El Shaddai. I thank you that you are faithful, Lord. I thank you that when we ask, we receive. I thank you, Lord, that you have chosen us, Lord. That you have searched us out and won our hearts, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that the work you lay before us is easy, Lord. And I thank you that the work you lay before us will bear eternal fruit. Lord, I thank you for each person here, Lord, that they are salt and light into this world. Jesus, Jesus, make your way known, Lord, that you will be lifted high, Lord, that you will be exalted, that we bring
yes,
glory
Lord.
To your kingdom, Lord, as you come and you meet with us this morning, Lord, that you have heard the needs, Lord, that young man who needs healing, Lord, as he comes out of prison, Lord, and he needs a way, Lord, a safe place, Lord. Oh, and we rejoice for the testimonies, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you're bringing Viviana home, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the favor that you've changed the workplace for James, Lord, where it's no longer stressful, Lord, but a blessing, Lord. Oh, we love to be in your house, Lord. We love to gather together in your presence, Lord. Well, oh, Jesus, that you would be lifted high today, Lord, that your name will be lifted high. Ever changed by these moments in your presence. I thank you, Lord, that you are our Father as we celebrate fathers today, fathers all across this world, Lord, that we take this time to celebrate you, our Heavenly Father, that you give good gifts to your children, that you are faithful, Lord, Jesus, that you have adopted us and called us your own, Lord, that we may also say, Abba, Father. Abba, Father, Jesus, we love you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you are more than enough, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Jesus. We ask you to be with our pastor this morning, Lord, with Nathan and Sally, and as they enter the final days of their vacation, Lord. Just ask that your spirit minister to them, Lord. Bring them home safely, Lord. And to all those members of our body who could not be here today, Lord, that you minister healing, Lord, that you minister encouragement, Lord, that you minister to them wherever they may be. And be with us all this morning in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. So again, happy Father's Day. If I have any little ones, I think I might have, I have some under there somewhere. I see a pink backpack.
It's Eric's.
Well, we'll be making some special Father's Day presents for the fathers. All right, let's speak the word this morning. Will you not receive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. And I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Yes. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
John, would you please come take the offering this morning? Thank you. Juan. John. We're missing the Don and the Don Juan.
Lord Jesus, we praise you today, God.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for this day that you have created for us, and that you are the God of it. And thank you for all of your love and goodness being our Heavenly Father on this day, Lord, because every day is our Heavenly Father's day. We just praise you, God, that we can gather in this place, give you, God, the praise that is due to your name.
Yes.
And God, we just lift you up and pray for those that are here and aren't here, and we just want to magnify you and pray for this offering.
Yes.
For your blessing, abundance, and multiplying it in the holy name of Jesus for your glory. Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Happy Father's Day. Hallelujah. Thank you,
yes.
Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Led to in this room right now. Yeah, there's a lot of people gone right now, but He's here. He says we're two or three gathered, He's here. I kind of feel sorry for those that aren't here, because we get to experience what God wants to do today in this room. Okay? So those that are watching or watching by tape and stuff, I pray that the essence of what the Lord does in this place this day reaches you too. Because in Psalms 97, it says, the Lord reigneth, and let the earth rejoice.
Yes.
And let the multitudes of the isles be glad thereof. And it goes on and talks about the fire goes before and takes care of all the situations in our lives. And the, even at the mountains, will just fall and be cast into the sea. The hills melt like wax at the presence of the Lord. We just want to worship the Father and say happy Father's Day to our Father in heaven.
Yes.
We just want to exalt Him and lift His name on high. We just want to glorify you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We just want to give it all to you. And as we worship you, Lord, let it go not only in the spirit realm to the north, or the south, the east, and the west, but let this, even this neighborhood and this region hear the praises of His people. Because, Lord, we've known and we've heard time and time again, as this body worships, there are extra voices and instruments that we don't see in our earthly eyes, but we hear in our heavenly ears that you have given us, Lord. We hear the choirs and the choruses and the instruments joining in. So, Lord, as we honor and worship you this day, Lord, we pray that all the earth would rejoice at your name. For you alone are worthy, Lord. You alone are worthy, Lord. You alone worthy, Lord. The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the people be glad that our God reigns. The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the people be glad. And our God reigns.
A fire.
A fire goes before him and burns up all his enemies. The hills well like wax at the presence of the Lord. At the presence of the Lord. The Lord reigns. Lord reigns. The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the people be glad that our God reigns. A fire goes before him and burns up all his enemies. The hills melt like wax at the presence of the Lord.
Yes.
At the presence of the Lord.
Yeah.
The Lord reigns.
The Lord reigns.
The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the people be glad that our God reigns. The heavens declare his righteousness. The people see his glory. For you, O Lord, are exalted over all the earth. Over all the earth, over all the earth. The Lord.
The Lord reigns.
Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the people be glad that our God reigns.
Voices, the Lord.
The Lord reigns.
The Lord reigns.
The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the people be glad that our God reigns.
Lord reigns.
The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns.
The Lord reigns.
Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the people be glad that our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord.
Glory to you, Lord.
Yes.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah, Lord.
because of you, because of you, because of your love, because of your blood. Oh, our sins are washed away, and we will live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. Oh, we'll see you face to face, and we will dance forever in the city of our God because of you.
No more pain.
No more pain.
Yeah.
No more sadness. No more suffering. No more tears. No more sin. No more sickness. No injustice.
Yes.
No more death.
Because of you. Because of your love.
Oh, our sins are washed away, and we will live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. Oh, we'll see you face to face, and we will dance together in the city of our God because of you.
There's joy.
There is joy everlasting. There is gladness. There is peace.
There is wine ever flowing. There's a wedding. There's a feast.
Because of you.
Because of you. Thank you, Jesus.
Because of your love. Because of your blood. Oh, our sins are washed away. We will live forever. And now we have this hope because of you. Oh, we'll see you face to face. We will dance together in the city of our God because of you.
Let's do that third verse again. There's joy. Come on, Suzanne. Here we go.
There is joy.
Everlasting.
There is gladness.
There is peace.
There's a wine ever flowing.
Yeah.
There's a wedding. There's a feast. Because of you. Because of you. Because of your love. Because of your love. Oh, I'll see you washed away. And we will live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. Oh, we'll see you face to face. And we will dance together in the city of our God. Because of you.
We'll see you face to face.
Oh, we'll see you face to face. We will dance together in the city of our God because of you.
Thank you, Myron. Let's do it again.
Thou Christ, the burning, cleansing flame, send the fire. the blood-bought gift today we claim. Send the fire today. Look down and see this waiting host. Give us the promised Holy Ghost. We want another Pentecost. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Oh, God of Elijah, hear our cry. Send the fire. He'll make us fit to live or die. Send the fire today to burn up every trace of sin, to bring the light and the glory in. The revolution now begin. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Send your fire today. We need your fire, Lord. We need your presence, Lord. Cause it's fire we want, for fire we bleed. Send your fire. The fire will meet our every need. So send your fire today, for strength to ever do the right, for grace to conquer in the fight, for power to walk the world in white. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Look down and see this waiting host. Give us the promised Holy Ghost. We want another Pentecost. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Send the fire today. Send the fire today. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
We need your fire, Lord. Breaks for your presence, oh God. Our heart breaks for your presence, oh God. Our heart breaks for your presence, Lord. We desire more of you, Lord. Lord, you said in Joel 2:28, and even again in Acts, Lord, that you would pour out your spirit in these last days. And we know that darkness abounds and is trying to quench that light and the fire. Even as a prayer meeting, Lord, across the country, Lord, the darkness tries to prevail, taking lives of our brothers and sisters. But you have shown your love, Lord, through those who are affected. As they forgive and as they love, as only you can love. As the media tries to turn this thing into a frenzy and turn this into a thing of hate, your bride, Lord, chose to love. And we know most of the media won't report that, Lord, because they don't understand your love. Lord, help us to reveal your love. Our lives, Lord, representing your love and the kingdom that is within us, oh God, when we gave our lives to you, that your spirit would pour out. For you alone are holy. For you alone are worthy. For you alone have a perfect love that man cannot understand, that this world so desperately needs. And I pray, Lord, Lord, not only your glory be shown to these, but to our children, Lord, and to our grandchildren who have not experienced the move of God. We need you, Lord, now. Lord, will you pour your rain upon this dry and thirsty land? It doesn't even know it's in a famine. California doesn't even know what the word drought really means. Let it rain, Lord. Let it rain, Lord. Let it rain, Lord. Let it rain, Lord. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon you. because he has anointed you to preach good news. The Spirit of the Sovereign God is upon you, because he has anointed you to preach good news. He has sent you to the poor. This is the year to bind up the brokenhearted.
This is the year
to bring freedom to the captive. This is the year to release the ones in darkness. This is the year of the favor of the Lord.
This is the day
of the vengeance of our God.
This is the year
of the favor of the Lord.
This is the day
of the vengeance of our God. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon you, because he has anointed you to preach good news. The Spirit of the Sovereign God is upon you, because he has anointed you to preach good news. He has sent you to the poor.
This is the year
to bind up the brokenhearted.
This is the day
to bring freedom to the captives.
This is the year
to release the ones in darkness.
This
is the year of the favor of the Lord.
This is the day
of the vengeance of our God.
This is the day
of the favor of the Lord.
This is
of the vengeance of our God. The vengeance of our God. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon us, because he has anointed us to preach good news. The Spirit of the Sovereign God is upon us, because he has anointed us to preach good news. He will comfort all who mourn.
This is the year.
He will provide for those who grieve in Zion.
This is the day.
He will pour out his oil of gladness.
This is the year.
Instead of mourning, you will pray.
This is the year
of the favor of the Lord.
This is the day
of the vengeance of our God.
This is the year
of the favor of the Lord.
This is the day,
because
our God is an awesome God.
He reigns
from heaven above with wisdom, power,
Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome
voices.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
One more time.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God's an awesome God. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah, folks. Hallelujah. God is good. God is good. God is so good. Thank God for the worship team up here. I want to give, you know, awesome. Awesome. Awesome to just thank God for them all, because they just sold out to the Lord, and that makes all the difference on it. Being sold out. You can be seated. Okay. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, I just thank Pastor for this opportunity to come and deliver what God has put on my heart. You know, I always take the pulpit seriously, to be able to share what God has done for you. Because it's all about Him. You know, that's what it's all about. And I know today is Father's Day. My first scripture I'm actually going to share is Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. And one thing about being a father, I've had the privilege to be a father and now grandfather. Just had the number 19 grandchild there Friday. Woo-hoo! So I'm thankful for little Eli. So just found that out, and I just thank God, because every life's precious. Every single life is precious. Everybody's worth something, God's kingdom. Everybody. You know, and that's what we have to look at. And when I was thinking about what a father meant, we got to really look at the character of God. I mean, that's what you have to look at to base something on a father. Because you know what, there's fathers that don't do as much they can for their kids, or maybe not see their kids, you know. But it's not just the father that actually was part of the birth, but the one that took care of the child. Because sometimes it may be a grandfather, it may be an uncle, it may be somebody else. Somebody that took the time to raise that child and invest in that child. You know, it's amazing. You can kind of see kids that don't get whatever's inside them just to be able to talk and let it out, because sometimes when they get around somebody that'll listen, it all comes out. They just want to just share and share and share and share, because, you know, when I was growing up, I don't think this was the best thing to say, but, you know, kids should be seen and not heard, and I said, what in the world is that for? I thought that was absolutely wrong, because they need to be heard. They need to be understood. They need to be listened to, because I found out if you don't listen to them at 2 and 3 and 4 and 5, when they get to be a teenager, they'll not come to you. You know why? Because you didn't listen to me then. One of the things I had my oldest granddaughter. My daughter called me one day and said, Daddy, I don't know if she's listening or if she's having a hearing problem. I don't know. She's just like, I have to just raise my voice and then she'll hear me. I said, well, maybe it is a hearing issue, you know, 'cause she's a good kid. So I came up and I was talking to her, and it was, you had to get real loud, and then I thought, no, I think she's got a hearing problem. So before we can actually get something physical, we want to go to the doctor, you know, and check and all that. But I discovered two ways she'd listen to me. One was
I could get down her level. She's only a couple years old. So I get on my knees and I can get on her level and look at her face to face, and she could see my eyes, she could see her mouth, she could understand what I was saying to her. Or I had to pick up and bring her up to here so we could see each other. And that just got to me. God uses those things in my life. I said, that's it. That's what Jesus did. Okay? He came down to our level, okay, so he could see us eye to eye. Hallelujah. And say, I understand what you're going through. And that's really where we have to be at when we deal with our kids and deal with those people that look in our life. Say, what's different about you? I've been there, bud. I've been to the cross. I've been changed. That's what's different. Because I got a father that listens to me and understands, that was willing to send his only begotten son to the cross for me. And I accepted that. So I'm gonna read this. Oh, I love this scripture. This is one of my favorite ones in the whole Bible. Now we look at the first part. For unto us. Who's us? We're part of the us. Let me tell you. We're part of the us. For unto us a child is born. Unto us a son is given. The governor should be called upon, should be upon his shoulder, and the name shall be called Wonderful. Hallelujah. Isn't that something? That God is wonderful. Jesus is wonderful. We think about, boy, that's something wonderful happened. That's where it starts at. Counselor. Isn't it great to have a counselor? Somebody that understands. Somebody that listens. You know what I found with people? I've been through counseling various things, and I remember going to a counselor over in Burlington years ago, and she was an older lady, and I remember she got me in, and the first, we had an hour, but probably about the first 45 minutes, it seemed like, it probably wasn't that long, but, you know, they always ask you what you come here for. There's got to be a reason you come in there, right? And she was so quiet, and she said, Tim, what'd you come in here for? And, boy, it's like a dam broke. So all this stuff was just coming out and coming out and coming out and coming out. And she sat there so patient. She didn't say a word. Just kind of nodded her head. Bonnie, I'll never forget Bonnie. And after it was all over, she said, you done now, Tim? You know, you done now? And she said, you know, Tim, you don't have to live that way. There's a better way to live. Whoa, man, pay that lady more. She got it. She got it. I don't have to. That's all I was looking for, somebody to say I didn't have to stay where I was at, that there could be a change. And that's it. And that got me going in the right direction. That Jesus does that all the time. You know, when he people always think about the woman that touched Jesus. You know, they had a crowd going, and the woman that had this blood sickness there for 12 years, she spent on living, and she pushed through the crowd, and she said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, that's it. If I can just touch him, I know I'd be healed. I know I will. Well, you know, if you've been in a big crowd football game where there's 30, 40,000 people, and they're walking around you, and they're pushing up against you, but you know when somebody's reaching out to you in the midst of that crowd. Because, you know, the Jesus said, who touched me? And say, what are you talking about? I mean, there's people pushing up against. No, you don't understand. Virtue went out of me. The healing power went out of me. Something changed. Somebody's reaching out to me. That was the difference. And that's what happened. You know, he turned around, and this woman's trembling. And says, you know, it was her daughter. You know, it's like he turned around, had so much compassion. He stopped the whole show. Daughter. And she just was trembling in front. What's going on? You know, and I'm putting a monitor. What's going on? And she told them all. Everything had happened. She spent all her money. The doctor said he couldn't do anything else. You know, and she just bared it all. And I love the way compassionate Jesus says, you know, hey, you know what? We're going to be healed now. That's what's going to happen. And you think she kept that silent when she went back home? No way. She went back to the doctor's office. I tell you what, you might not have done something, but Dr. Jesus did something for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you what, I've seen that happen. I took a bad fall one day, and I always like to think about what God has done for you. Never, ever forget that. Never. You don't want to dwell in the past, but never, ever forget that. And I just remember when I took a bad fall down some stairs at work one time when I worked for Walmart, and I fell face down, and it was concrete steps with steel on the end of them. And I'm telling you, I was bigger than I was. So I'm not skinny now, but I was bigger than this, let me tell you. And I remember falling. You know, you just sense yourself falling. There's no rail I could grab. So when I fell, And I fell face down, and I heard a loud pop, and I thought I broke my leg. But I ended up cutting a tendon connected thigh muscle to the knee. It was really bad. But when I hit face down, I realized that my hair was against the wall of the landing. And I realized if I came down another half step, my face would have hit the wall, and I'm sure I would have broke my neck. I'm absolutely sure, because my face would have been like this, and pushing 470 pounds down that step, I think I would, you know, it could have been a lot worse. And so I just thank God, and I remember I went to Iowa City Hospital, and I talked to the doctor, and they were going to put me back together. So after surgery, I'm lying. They took me to the hospital room, and this guy was on TV. I never had seen this guy as evangelist on there. Tell me God can't reach you where you're at. So this evangelist was going on, and he said this: God loves you, and God can use you even if you fell down the stairs. I'm saying hallelujah. How'd that guy know that? How'd he know that? There's no way he could have known that. But God knew I was going to be there, and God had a plan for my life. That's really what we got to always look at every time when things happen. You know, think about being a counselor. I love the fact up here says, the mighty God. Now, when we think about mighty, I mean, some of us grew up with Mighty Mouse. You know, he had the little Mighty Mouse running around saving. Yeah, he always had his big muscles up here. We got a bigger than Mighty Mouse, let me tell you. We have a mighty God. One, I tell you what, that can do mighty things. Yeah. Think about that. You know, we think about all the darkness and stuff that's going on, but you tell you what, nothing's too big for God. Nothing is too big for God. Hallelujah. Sometimes we say, oh, I don't know, God, my situation's pretty bleak. So what? So what? I'm bigger than that situation. You know, I was Friday night, was going home, and you know, sometimes you see different things in the cloud. God speaks with you different ways. He does. You know? And I saw that it was a great big cloud, because there's been a lot of sharks in the news, you know? And for sad state, but you know. But that's what it looked like, a great big shark, okay? And then there was a little cloud, like going in a shark's mouth. And I remember looking at that cloud, it's like, you know, what are you trying to say? Then it just was so clear. I said, Tim, this is what I'm trying to say to you. See, those problems that you think are so big, I could just like a shark and swallow them up. That's what I can do. They're not big to me. They're not bigger than I am. That's what I always got to realize. The situation going through are not bigger than what God can handle. I'm telling you, somebody that creates the world, I think he can handle what you're going through. And so many times during the course of a day, he will show you himself. He will show you how good he is. Sometimes the problem is we always look at the bad stuff. Well, I don't know if I have enough to pay my bills. I said, well, that ain't nothing new. A lot of people don't get that. But you know what? I can pray to God. I can pray to God. You know, maybe God give me some extra work. You know? You don't be surprised. Somebody, hey, God told me to give you this. You know, I've had that happen too. Or somebody bring you groceries over there. Or somebody do something for you. You know, we got to start looking at the positive things that God does and start dwelling on the negative. You know, I know as Mike was sharing about the awful situation in South Carolina, I mean, it tears you out, God's people. And, we, you know, that's in the conversation we was talking about. I said, well, you know, every one of those that got shot, it's sad, but, you know, where were they at? They were where they were supposed to be, in the house of God, amen. Right? And they were sitting there praying, doing Bible study. They was doing everything. Those things do happen. But you know what? God's still God, and God can take his situation and turn around. The young man was in the Bible study, right? And we sat there for an hour before he started. But you know what? Somebody said, well, why didn't God do something? Why didn't God? Well, I'll tell you what, that young man, he sat there, okay? But, you know, if you're hungry, you can see a loaf of bread on the table, but it's not going to help you unless you eat it, right? You can be as hungry as, unless you take it inside, because that's what God does. He starts from the inside out. He takes our heart. That's what happened. It never got inside. That, hey, yeah, let me tell you, when Jesus gets inside, he'll work in your life, and he can tell you what's wrong. He can tell you what's right. He can guide you. That's the difference. You know, it's not just a matter of coming to church and sitting in a pew. It's coming in, hearing God's word, and doing something with it. That's the big thing. That's where I think we don't always move to. Because I'm telling you, I've been around so long, and I do driving a lot myself. And let me tell you, some of the calmest people, they act so different when they get behind the wheel. Let me tell you. I rode with an individual like that. I ain't going to mention names, but let me tell you. He was a deacon in church, powerful person. You know, I looked up to him until he started driving. Let me tell you. I don't know where the holiness went, but I think it didn't make it in the car. Let me tell you that. Oh, I can't stand there. Oh, I can't wait. And I know the right light's red. I tell you what, we'll cut through this parking lot and come out the other side. Whew. Man, I tell you what, if you wasn't saved that day, you're going to be saved afterwards, because you was crying out to the Lord and hanging on, hanging on. What kind of driving is this? You done turned into incredible hope. You know, the thing about being a godly person is it's got to be godly 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We can't take a time off for godliness. People do that all the time. Well, you know, I've been good for so long, and, you know, I think I'll take a break. No, that ain't the way it is. What God wants us to do is be holy all the time. Because I'm telling you, people are watching you. You know what? And they're watching the times you don't think they are. Yeah? Is that true? The one time you think they're not watching, they're watching you. My daughter and I went to McDonald's there at home when I lived down in Mount Pleasant. And I gave the lady a $10 bill. You know what she gave me back? $20 change. I gave her 10, but she gave me $20 worth of change back. And so my daughter's in the car and says, Daddy, man, we got extra money. I said, really? Is that really our money? You know it's not our money. Now her drawer is going to be messed up. She could get fired. What would be the best thing to do? Give it back to her. That's the best thing to do, because you got to live with that. The thing is, a person has to live with their self, okay? And I tell you what, I remember being in Wichita, Kansas, and I would go to churches when I ran the road, and this lady got up and sang. She said, the safest place to be is in the center of God's will. That's how. It doesn't mean things won't happen to you, but God's right there with you. That's what you always got to remember. Let's never forget that. This verse here was gone now, but I got it here. Coming back up. I'm sorry I didn't get down through fast enough. But the mighty God, the everlasting Father, everlasting. What does that mean? Just what it says, everlasting. He'll always be with you. And look at that, the Prince of Peace. How many do want peace in their life? Let me tell you, peace. Some people cannot sleep because they got too much stuff circling around in their head at night. Oh, Lord, what am I going to do about that? And my mom, God bless her, she would always say, don't worry. God's going to take care of her. God will provide. I didn't get that when I was a kid, because some of the food we had to eat, I got to wondering, let me tell you. We go pick greens up off the side of the road, man, and eat them. I'm thinking, there's got to be something a little better than this. But he says, Tim, you need to be thankful. Some people didn't have nothing to eat. You know, some people didn't have a roof over their head. So you need to be thankful for what God has done. You know, when he provided the job, maybe that's not the job that you want right now, your ideal job, but it gets your foot in the door. You know, and God can provide another opportunity. The thing about God, he's always working forward. That's what he's doing. He's always preparing you for something better, something bigger. He don't just leave you where you're at, you know, emotionally. And he wants to work with you so you can be a better example of him. Because I'm telling you, people do look at you. People say, well, man, all these other people are getting upset. How come you're so calm? How come you just are so relaxed back here? Like I could put you in the middle of a tornado and you'd just be perfectly calm. Because I know, even in the midst of that tornado, God's going to be with me. You know, and let's go to Daniel chapter 3. Daniel 3. I'm going to start. Daniel chapter 3. This is the Hebrew boys in the furnace. Okay. And I'm going to look at Daniel chapter 3. And let's just start in. Actually, let's start in about verse 7. Daniel 3, verse 7. Then I'll give you some other verses. But let's just start in verse 7. We kind of know in Daniel chapter 2 where Daniel had talked to Nebuchadnezzar about this image of all we didn't go through all of it, but he talks about this image to Nebuchadnezzar. Well, like some people, you know, God was giving Nebuchadnezzar a picture of future kingdoms and stuff. So Nebuchadnezzar decides to build this big statue of this. Well, the problem with that, he builds this big statue, and he invites all these people, and he wants them to worship this statue. And I think what is really amazing is that so many people actually did. So many people didn't seem to have a question. They just went along with the crowd. I remember I had a cousin, and he was from California, and he drove a cab in Los Angeles. And somebody said, man, aren't you scared of the gangs? Aren't you scared of the gangs out there? I never forget what he said. He said, God is my gang. That's all. God is my gang. He's going to take care of me. You know, just because the crowd says this is okay doesn't make it okay. You know, and we've got to follow God even if the whole crowd is not good. Because God makes you majority. That's what makes it. All you need is to go with God. Now, I'm going to look at this. Now, and we look at how that at the time when all the people heard the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and psaltery and all kinds of music, all the people of the nation and language fell down and worshiped the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And what he's going to do, if you did not worship this idol, he's going to throw you in the furnace right now. Okay? But what happened is that in verses, it talks about, see, that's verse 7, and verse 8, now we got to look at what's going to happen is that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who were Daniel's friends, they had been appointed over the affairs of the province of Babylon. These three Hebrews, they weren't going to do it because they loved the Lord God. That's who they loved. They wasn't going to do it. Now, what happened was, therefore, and go to verse 8 and 9, please. And you're already there. Good. Therefore, at the time, certain men of Chaldean descent came near and brought malicious accusations against the Jews. Now, think about it. Where at times certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. Who three Jews? Those three. Then they spake and said to King Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. And go ahead and go to verse 10. 10 and 11, please. Okay. Thou, O king, has made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, all kinds of music, shall fall down and worship the golden image, and whosoever fall not down and worship, that he should be cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Okay? And let's keep going a little bit. I'll go down to 15, so I'll read this verse. There are certain Jews who they set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these men, O king, have not regarded thee. They're not even listening to you, king. They're standing up when everybody else is bowing down. You're going to have to do something about this. These men have not regarded, they serve not thy gods. Hallelujah. Nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. And that's really where we got to come to. We got to make our mind up. Who are we going to serve? Whose side are we on? You remember Moses did that when Aaron, they had made the calf and the golden calf and all, and he finally said, all right, fellas, who's on the Lord's side? And that's really where we're coming to this day and age. Who's on the Lord's side? Who's going to stand up? And that's exactly the way we have to do it. And sometimes it's so difficult to do that, to stand up. But you know what? We got to be men. We got to be women of God, and we got to stand up. And say, no, wait a minute, I'm not going to bow down to this image. I'm not going to give up to it. You know why? Because my God is greater than this. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay, would you go on to verse 12? Verse 12, 13, and 14. If you would. Okay, and now I'm going to read verse 13. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage, he found out, man, he was a hothead, what he was. And fury commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, then they brought these men before the king. Just go ahead and continue. Okay. Now Nebuchadnezzar spake and said to them, is it true? Wait, maybe I got something wrong here. Maybe they don't have it right. Oh, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I set up. Now I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you another chance. Maybe you didn't understand what was happening here. Maybe something was communicated. Now if you'd be ready, at the time that you hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, all kinds of music. You fall down and worship the image which I have made. But if you worship not, she'll be cast the same hour into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And just keep, who it is that God, keep going up a few more verses. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, I love this. It's such a relaxed answer. You know, it's like they're not getting the feathers ruffled whatsoever. I love this. Oh, Nebuchadnezzar, we're not careful to answer thee in this matter. We don't really need to answer you. Our statement was made when we were standing up. You want to know the truth? Our statement was made when we did not bow down. But in case you want to know, we're going to tell you. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. He will deliver us out of the hand, O king. Go up to 18. There you go. Thank you. But if it not, be it known unto thee. Even if our God choose to deliver us, that's fine. If he doesn't, let me tell you something, O king, that we will not serve thy God, nor worship the golden image thou hast set up. This is what's going to happen. God deliver us, fine. If he doesn't deliver us, we won either way. Because if we die in the fire, we're going to go be with him. Right? And if he deliver us, what a testimony. Right here on earth. So we won either way. But I tell you what, we're not going to serve your God. We're not going to bow down. And that's really where God wants to come. Who's on the Lord's side? Who's willing to make that stand and say, you know what? Tell you what, you can burn me up. It doesn't matter because I'm going to go be with the Lord. You can put me in the furnace, but we're going to see a little later. Now listen, then was Nebuchadnezzar, boy, if he was mad, hothead before, now he's really a hothead. Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of rage and formed his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He spake, commanded they should heat the furnace one seven times more than it was wont to be heated. That's hot. Think about that. Seven times more than he was made to be heated. Can you imagine that hot? If you've been a while welding and stuff like that, you see that heat there? Okay? And he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. All right, fellas. We'll see your God if he can deliver you. We're going to see. This is going to be the test. You talking, let's see what's going to happen. And they bound him up. But you know what? I love this. His army bind Shadrach, and they cast him in the burning fire. Listen, you got to keep this in mind. These men were bound in their coats, their hosen, their hats, and their other garments, and were cast in the midst of the burning fire furnace. Now, we get this picture. God didn't deliver them outside the furnace, right? Because they're being cast in there. Therefore, verse 22, because the king's command was so urgent, the furnace exceedingly hot, the flames of the fire slew those men that took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That's hot. When they threw them in, their life was gone. You know, they all died. One thing I'm saying, you can't mess with God's kids and he not do something about it. You know, sometimes it's right away, sometimes it's later. But it's like picking on your own kids. Somebody pick on your own kids, you're going to do something about it. I tell you, you start picking on God's kids, he's going to do something about it. You know, he loves your kids. And look what happened. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound into the midst of the burning fire furnace. A few more verses, please. Now, this is what I love. I love this. The Nebuchadnezzar king was astonished. And he rose in haste and spake, said his time. Oh, because, you know, you got a picture. He's gazing in there. They're gone now. It killed my men and threw them in there. They're all gone. But I'm going to go over and look. Oh, hey, wait a minute. Did we not cast three men? Sure he knows that. He knows he talked to them. Did he not cast three men bound in the midst of the fire? They answered to the king, true, O king. Why even ask that? You know it was three men. But wait a minute. He answered, wait a minute. Lo, I see four men. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, isn't that? Oh, hallelujah, that's worth the praise right there. I see four men loose walking in the midst of fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Hallelujah. Do you see what's happening? Hallelujah. They fell down in the fire, but now they're loose, and who's walking with them? Jesus Christ is there. He's walking with them, the Son of God. Hallelujah. He's inside the furnace with them. Oh, hallelujah. That's worth a whole lot of praise right there. To thank God. They had to go in the furnace, but God was in there with them. Hallelujah. Give me another verse. Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fire furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you servants of the Most High God. He's realizing something now. You know, he's realizing something. That's when he's serving the Most High. Come forth and come hither. Now this is powerful. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth out of the midst of the fire. And all these people that saw this, all he had invited, these big wigs, you know, the princes, governors, and captains, and the king's counselors being gathered together, saw these men. Now can you imagine? Upon whose body the fire had no power. Yeah. Hallelujah. The fire couldn't burn them up. Let me tell you. Nor was a hair of their head singed. I mean, that's a miracle. Think about it. Neither were their coats changed. Go up. Then Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, now, before this all happened, he didn't have this attitude, Nebuchadnezzar, because he was mad at him for not bowing down to his God. But something was changing. They had a testimony. They was willing to share it. Look what something said. Then Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Hallelujah. Who has sent his angel and delivered his servant that trusted in him and have changed the king's word. Because he is more powerful than the earthly kings were. We think, oh, that's the law. I tell you what, there's one supreme law, and that's the law of God. That's what makes all the difference right there. Hallelujah. They had yielded their bodies that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own God. And look what happens to him. So the king's going to change something right here. He said, therefore, I make a decree that every people, nation, and language would speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego should be cut in pieces. Hallelujah. Then the king promoted. Look at this. After all that stuff they went through, then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. Yeah, they got their promotion when? After they went through the fire. Hallelujah. What a powerful testimony. When people see you going through different things and you come out the other side and God can promote you. Because it really does depend on your attitude. How you go through those things. You know, a lot of times we say, oh man, God, this is too much. This is too much. Well, maybe too much for you. But it's not too much for me. What you need to do is put the trust in me. Okay? I never give you too much to bear. The problem is we try to take it on ourselves. Instead, sometimes what you need to do is you need to get your brothers and sisters together. Would you pray for me? Would you believe with me? And that takes some of that burden off there. So many people are crying for that. Just somebody to pray with them. Read the Bible with them. Study with them. That is so powerful. Every day, my mom talked to her sister. And when I had prayer requests, Aunt Louise and my mom would talk every morning. About 6 o'clock in the morning. And I knew that if I called down a prayer request, I'm going to tell Aunt Louise, we're going to go to prayer. And they went to prayer year after year after year. And I just said, thank God for them. Because I knew their prayers went past the ceiling over here. You know, the thing about it is people pray, the older saints, they really understood that. The newer ones, as we get, Lord, you've got some people that really will pray for you. Not people that say, I'm going to pray for you. Then you ask them, did you pray? Oh, I forgot. What was it? What was your quest? There was a lady that went to our church. I used to go to Kingsway years ago. Leafy Blair. Never will forget Leafy Blair. The only thing she did in the church, she was probably 80, in her 80s. And they said, Tim, if you need a prayer request, you need an answer, you need a job or concern, go to Leafy Blair. So I found out Leafy Blair. Show me who she is. And I could say she was probably in her 80s then. And she always called you young man. Whenever you went to her, young man, can I help you, young man? Yes, they said I could come to you and I could ask you to pray for me. I said, what you need? I said, well, I'd like to get a job. I need a job, provide for my family more than what I'm doing now. And he said, oh, yes, I'll be glad to pray for you. Let's pray right now. I'm not going to take that prayer request home. I may pray at home, but I'm going to pray with you right now. And I'm telling you, I reached out. She reached out hand. I reached out. She had a grip on her. And I'm telling you what, she grabbed my hand. Lord, bless this young man. Get a job. Get the right job. And she was squeezing my hand a little tight for being 80-some years old. She had a grip. And I knew there was something going to change. Because the Bible said, whether it's two or three touching the green, you'd be in the midst. And I'm telling you, there's something that went powerful when she touched my hand. And she prayed for, and you know what? Been working ever since. end up having the best jobs I ever got. And I look at back at Leafy Blair, and before she had passed away, I sent a letter to her family, and her daughter got it. I said, I just want to thank your mom for praying for me. I want to thank her for that. Claire, back in the early 80s, I want to thank your mom for that, because that meant something to me, that she took time out of her life to pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to share another thing with you here. But you know one thing about it? God is good, folks. Let's never forget where he brought you. I know you hear me say that over and over again, but let me tell you, it's powerful. Deuteronomy 6:5. We all know that by heart, right? Deuteronomy 6:5. Oh, man. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart. Hallelujah. With all thy soul and with all thy might. Tell you what, that takes care of a lot of the ills in the human family right there. If people would do that, if people would realize I need God in my life and I need to love the Lord God with all thine heart, with everything inside of me, that makes a whole lot of difference. You know, David said, I hid the word in my heart, might not sin against you. When you have that word of God, he can tell you. You know, some people don't listen. You know, sometimes, like I said before, sometimes they pray after the fact. God, get me out of this trouble. I said, well, why didn't you pray before you got into trouble? You should have asked me first. Because God can tell you. But see, some people don't want to hear God tell them no. You know, if I ask God, I mean, they'll do it sometime in relationships. Instead of saying, God, at the beginning, Lord, show me if I should be involved with this person. Because God can show you the person's heart. I remember when I was single that I went out to, my daughter lived out in Philadelphia, and I went on a Wednesday night church service, and there's no way, unless she told the pastor that I was coming out there, but whatever sermon that was, what he was going to preach on. But you know, he said, all you singles out there, well, how do you know that? He always singles says, before you decide if that's the person, why don't you ask God to show you that person's heart? And I thought, how powerful is that? How simple that is. But what happens is they get kind of wrapped up in the relationship, you know, and their heart falls for them, and they don't want to ask because God might say no, now you got all wrapped up. But I'm telling you, it keeps you a lot of heartache if you pray before and say, God, is this the person? Is this the person I should be with and spend the rest of my life with that person? Is this the right person? Is this the right car I should buy? Is this the right house I should buy? Is this the right neighborhood? One of the things that happened when I first moved up here, and I ended up moving out to Johnson, but I was going to get a job in the south side of Des Moines off of Highway 5, and there was an apartment out there in Norwalk. It was big. I loved it. It was roomy. It had full-size, you know, apartments. Also, in the small, everything was full-size. Man, I just thought it was a good fit. And so I was actually going down there to sign the lease because, you know, as I was going down there, I felt there was a job down there. Everything was working. And all of a sudden, God said, Tim, you need to be on the north side of Interstate 80. Okay. Turned around. It went up north side 80. So I'm driving through and see apartments and everything. And I went over to a Wynwood Apartments there in Johnston. And I saw this sign, you know, they had apartments open. And I drove through and went down to the clubhouse, you know. Now, at that time, I only had $75 in my checking account. You know, I was expecting some money soon. So I only had $75. So went in there and said, you interested in apartment stuff? He says, yeah, I'd like to rent your apartment, lease apartment. I said, okay. But you rented it at the best time possible. Because normally our application fee is $55. But you know what it is today, Tim? It's $25. Whew. Praise the Lord. I didn't know that. And he says, you know what? The deposit on these apartments is usually $250. You know what it is today, Tim? $25. Now, how did I know that? I didn't know that. God knew that, because God knew I only had $75 in the account anyway. Okay? But, you know, I signed there and I lived there for quite a while. But God saw ahead. And then I end up going to a church out there. You know, and it was a great church, great fit. I learned a lot. You know, God had me at the right place. And that's what God will do for you. If we start with here, and thou should love the Lord God with all thy heart, with all their soul, with all their mind. And I don't you ever forget that. That's where it all starts. Will you love the God that much? God, I don't understand what's going on right now. I'm hurting. But you know what? I'm going to trust you. I'm going to love you no matter what. That's where devotion comes through. And I'm gonna close with this. This is, I got to read this because I get a lot of stuff that, you know, there's some good stuff on the internet too. You know, not all of it's trash. Sometimes there's a good stuff on the Facebook too. There's some positive stuff on the prayer request. I put prayer requests on there. But I gotta share this about this young man, William Whiting Borden. And the one thing about him, you probably will remember the quote, may not necessarily remember him that much, but it's just one of those things that really touched my heart a lot. And William Borden, he was really born in life of influence, affluence, and then he came to, they was from Colorado, and he came to Chicago and ended up, his mom took him to what is now known as Moody Church, and he ended up becoming a Christian, and he felt God calling him into missions, and they was worth a lot of money. And he ended up forsaking the life in the corporate world to go to missions, and he ended up donating $1 million to the Christian Inland Mission. But he ended up dying early. He contracted disease and died early at 25. But his mom was given his Bible. And I just so touched by this. His mom was given his Bible. So I'm gonna read this. So just bear with me. Say, some say after his death, this is William Whiting Borden, his Bible was given to his mother. In one place, she found the words, no reserves, and a date renouncing his fortune in favor of missions. Later, he had written, no retreats, after his father told him he could never work in his company again. Shortly before he died in Egypt, he added, no regrets. That just tears my heart out. No reserves, because why? We're dependent on God. That's what we're doing. We're not dependent on a bank account. We're not dependent on a stock exchange. We're dependent on Jesus Christ. And he written, no retreats. I'm not going to back up. You know, Shadrach and them, I'm not going to be thrown in the fire here. We're going to stop this. You know, bring it on. Bring it on. Throw me in the fire. I'm still going to serve God in the fire, outside the fire. Bring it on. He written, no retreat. And can you imagine at the end of his life, short before he died, no regrets. Hallelujah. And that's really where our life should be. You know, we don't need to have any regrets serving God. One time, a young man approached me one time, and he says, you know, Tim, the problem, my grandma, she believes in God too much. And I, you know, sometimes you learn to not say stuff, but that one, I had to say stuff. There's no way I could let that slide. There's no way, you know. I said, let me tell you, young man, you can never believe in God too much. You can never. You can never know him fully. You just keep going and going and going in him. Paul said, you know, to know him. That was chief. He wanted to know him inside and out, to know him. You know, you can't, to know the height and depth of God's love, how are we going to do that? You spend time with him, and you get to know the character of God. Spend time with, and you know, when you get out in prayer, it's not always lopsided either. You know, we tell God, we give this list. God, I want this, I want this, I want this. I understand that. I understand your needs. You know, it's nice just to go to God and say, you know, God, I love you today. I'm not coming to you for nothing. I'm not asking these requests. You know, I love my son, my oldest, but it's always funny because the kids always want money. You know, and he called me, I said, okay, how much do you need? He said, well, how come you didn't think I was just calling you to say hi? I might have just called to say hi. You know, see how you're doing. And then so he got to, I said, well, okay, maybe I was wrong. And at the end, well, you know, if you have a few dollars, I would appreciate if you did have a few dollars for me. Now. But you know what? God likes to hear that. You know what, God? Happy Father's Day. Yeah. You know, I love you. That's who I love. I love you with my whole heart. God, if it wasn't for you, where would I be? I could be lost on a downward spiral, but now I'm on an upward staircase because I'm going in the right direction. You are always going in the right direction when you go with God. The one thing about it, we used to sing that song, Soul Say Yes. I remember we used to sing that when we were growing up. Soul say yes. Soul say yes. Yes. Say yes to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to end with a prayer, if it's all right. Oh, Father God, thank you for the fathers out there. Thank you for those fathers who say, you know what? I'm going to teach my kids about you. Thank you for those fathers and mothers who will pray with their kids. Keep them before you. That realize that, hey, watch over my son. Watch over my daughter. Watch over my grandkids. Because they realize the value. Because there's value in serving you, Lord. Lord, we thank you so much because you have that everlasting love for us. Oh, Lord, I ask you to put your arms around everybody in this room, their families, and let them know. Just give them this great big hug and tell them, I love you, my child. I love you. I love you. I love you. And I'm never going to stop loving you. There's nothing you can do. I'm still going to love you. You know, talks about even if I make my bed in hell, which means I'm probably going to come back again. God is still there. Hallelujah. You can't run away from him because he loves you that much. You're still my child, like the prodigal son that was a long way off. And his father saw him. That's my son. Thank you for bringing him home. Yeah. There's not one day when he wasn't my son. I still love him. Well, Dad, I did this and I did. Oh, hey, cut that out. Cut that out because you're home now. Hey, bring the robe. Hallelujah. Bring the ring. Bring the shoes because you're home now. Hallelujah. My son, you was lost, but now you're found. Now you can see you're going to be with me forever. Oh, hallelujah. Yes, celebration. We're going to throw a party. Hallelujah. Because you're home. You're home. And Father God, bless everybody today. Watch over them this week. And Lord, just touch them. And this week, reveal yourself to them in a mighty way. Let them see you this week. And let them cry out to you and say, thank you, God. That was you. That was you. I know it was you. In your wonderful holy name. Yes. Hallelujah. For your wonderful holy name. Yes, we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. All right. God bless you. And y'all have a great Father's Day. Woo!